I apologize for the delay. We're having some technical issues, but good morning and welcome to our November installment of the CVUT Inovacentrum and UNYP Entrepreneurship Lab. I'd like to welcome Sotiris Karagiannis as our speaker today, and welcome to those of you also joining us via webcam. If you have any questions later on, feel free to type them into the chat window, and I will relay your questions to Mr. Karagiannis. And of course, we'll have a question and answer session here at the end of the talk. So, thank you.
Thank you, too. So, welcome and good morning, everybody. I really feel happy to be here. I'm coming to Prague to teach at the University of New York in Prague for the last almost 10 years. And one of my favorite topics is what we're going to talk about today in hopefully in a very interactive mode, so not just, you know, lecturing for an hour and a half. I remember when I was here for the first time, I was in a class that was the most diverse class I ever had in my 20 or 22 year career. So I had Czechs and Slovaks, of course, being the majority of the people. I had Dutch, Croatians, Serbians, a Polish student, a student from the Netherlands, an American, a Cypriot, two Chinese, a Mexican, and myself, a Greek. Now, for me, that was a great challenge, because as you understand, talking about leadership, which is the field I'm mostly involved in, it was interesting to see how people view leadership from all these different cultural backgrounds. So you could have people who thought about leadership as an area where the leader simply directs, tells other people what they have to do, and they do it. Some other people were on the other side, and they thought that leadership is about working together with other people, participating, and helping your people through your vision. I started realizing that even though my idea about leadership was perhaps closer to the second type of leadership, the more participative one, it was important to listen to what other people had to say. And as I was coming here every year and had the same experience, this diversity that you don't see in many cities, at least in Europe, I started realizing how beneficial it is to interact with people from such a diverse background. Now, you look at the title, it's Managing Diversity, and I would like to, as I said, make it interactive, so turn to you and ask you, when you see the word diversity, what is the first thing that really comes to your mind? One by one, please, not everybody at the same time. So, what do you think about diversity? What do you think we really mean by diversity?
Different cultures?
So, different cultures getting together in an organizational environment or in a social environment. Would there be anything else? Yes?
Different backgrounds in education?
Backgrounds, different backgrounds in education.
Different opinions, different beliefs.
Different beliefs and different opinions.
Life okay. attitude.
Sorry?
Life attitude.
Uh-huh. All right. So, it's good to see that we don't think of diversity as people used to think about it maybe 20 years ago. That it's mainly about dealing with people coming from different national ethnic backgrounds, maybe different religions. Okay, it's more than that. It's much more than that. And the more globalized our world is turning, the more the need to be able to manage diversity in any kind of setting, whether we are in Europe, in America, in Africa, in Asia, or in Australia. So, as you correctly said, diversity is not only about ethnicity, race, or gender. It's about all these differences from people that are very different from us, not only in what we said here, race, religion, and the rest, but also even in the way they think. For example, in Nissan, in Japan, in the research and development department, for every engineer they hire who works with the right part of the brain, the next person they hire in the same department should work with the left. Any ideas why they do that? Because obviously people with the right brain have a different way of thinking and looking at new ideas as opposed to somebody with the left. So what they want at Nissan, and surely in many other organizations, is to be able to combine the talents, the problem-solving abilities, the skills of people in order to come up with the best possible idea. So if they were hiring people who use the same way of thinking or solving problems, eventually it is highly likely that they would miss out some other great opportunities. And this is what I want to pass as a message to you, that diversity is not only about the things we used to know 20 or 30 years ago. So, to cut a long story short, when we talk about diversity, it's all these things you can see on the screen. Age and ethnicity, ancestry, where we are coming from, who were our fathers, gender, physical abilities and qualities, race, even sexual orientation, background, educational background, as you said, geographic location. I had a personal culture shock when I was going to Cyprus, and in Cyprus they speak Greek as well, but with a different accent. That was 20 years ago, there were no cellular phones to use to wake up in the morning. So I asked the receptionist to give me a morning wake-up call. And the phone rings, I lift the receiver, and the lady on the other side says, "Mr. Karagiannis, your time has come." Now, how would you actually interpret this message? I believe in every culture the message is absolutely different, that short are my days. But what she actually meant was that it's about time you wake up. And that was in Greek. So you can understand that even between cultures that are so close together, there can be differences that we need to learn and understand, because only in this way will we be able to live and interact in this diverse and global environment. Can we measure diversity? Let me hide this thing for a bit, using my magic tricks with a computer. So can we measure diversity? Any ideas? You are an organization and you want to measure diversity. You want to see how effective your organization is in terms of managing diversity in this setting. What would be some ideas you could use in order to measure it?
To let employers pass some tests which will show you the actual...
Okay, that would be one thing, to use some metrics. Any other ideas?
Most basic way is the number of different nationalities that they always...
Okay, so you have a record actually of how many people come and work in your company from different backgrounds. Are they all the same? For example, in some fields, as you know very well, like in information technology, this is still a male-dominated area. You don't see too many females working in IT, even though now it's changing. But my experience 20 years ago, when I was doing training for IT companies, it was an all-male group. No single woman was in that team. This is changing, but still there are situations where the ratio is probably 20-80, if we use Pareto's rule, but not more than that. Has anybody heard about the so-called glass ceiling effect? Does it ring a bell to anybody? Okay. 25 years ago, in the United States, they were measuring in the workforce, how many women can make it to the top of the organization? So in other words, become CEOs, chief executive officers. And the statistics were not very encouraging for the number of women who actually made it up to the top. So the researchers conceived this term, which is called glass ceiling, which means that back in those times, in many male-dominated companies, women could see through this glass ceiling who was sitting at the top, but knew they could never reach that place. So their only hope was to reach up to a maybe human resources manager's level, or sometimes CFO, chief financial officer, but the chance of them finally becoming the CEO of the company were very slim. And they called this thing glass ceiling effect. You could see through, but you can never touch it. Again, this is changing, but still, we know even in more developed economies, like the Western type economies, that women in many jobs are underpaid compared to men, that don't make the same amount of money, even though they produce the same, and sometimes they may be even more efficient, more multitasked than men. So these are ways we can measure diversity. There are diversity metrics by consulting firms that some big companies can also use. However, as the diversity manager, if you like, of Microsoft said, it's not only about putting these things in a scorecard. It's more about how we as leaders or managers in an organization understand the importance of putting ourselves in the shoes of another person and trying to figure out why this person behaves in the way they do, what is the background that may explain this kind of behavior, and what we can do in order to help this person feel that he or she is included in the family of this organization. So we go one step more than just measuring with numbers how diverse we are. Diversity is important because we can understand what motivates people. We can understand about their performance. We can understand about how they interact, how they understand success in organizations. Now, I have an analogy for you. Suppose you're a manager in an organization and you have a person who is working, a manual worker, coming from a developing country, who is working really hard in your company, and you want to reward this person and give him some motivators. So at the end of the year, you call him in your office and you tell him, hey, I really want to recognize your hard work and I really want to give you a reward. So in recognition of your work, I'm going to give you a 1 year's free subscription at the local tennis club. How would you feel if you were in this person's shoes? An immigrant from a poor country coming here to work, and your boss at the end of the year tells you, you got 1 year's free subscription at the local tennis club. By the way, congratulations on the tennis, on the Czech tennis team for winning the Davis Cup. You deserved it. I felt a little sorry for Djokovic. I could see his face. He wasn't very happy, but what can we do? So how would you feel if you were that person? Happy?
Not really.
Why? Why not?
Well, he doesn't even have to play tennis. And he probably would much more appreciate if he got some money or maybe a raise because he's from a developing country and he could send it to his family or something.
Exactly. So what was my mistake as a manager? What did I do?
Which was wrong? Do any research about him. And
I didn't think at all about this person's real needs. And I thought that what perhaps motivates me for my social status or for anything else would be exactly what this person would want. So I looked at things from my own perspective, ignoring, overlooking totally what this person really needs to motivate himself and perhaps his family. Now, is this something that happens often in real life? Yes. Yes. In many situations at work, especially when we work in a diverse environment, many times we fail to recognize that people are different, and because they are different, they have to be treated in a different way. We're going to see how easy or difficult this is. But as a first insight, we need to understand and show empathy and try really to put ourselves in the other person's place. Which takes me to my next slide about managing diversity. Organizations that have a universal presence are beginning to understand the need to manage diversity in a very, if you like, professional and very specific context. That's why companies like Microsoft, for instance, they already have a manager in diversity. And he is a high-ranking official in this organization. Same thing applies to many international organizations that have branches across the globe. So when we manage diversity, it means we look for systems, for practices, for ways to help people apply all their talents at work, and at the same time ensure that some of the negative things about not managing diversity are out of our organization. So on one hand, we promote diversity, we promote inclusion, we want to make people feel they are treated like equals, and at the same time we make sure that some things that in the past created problems are no longer in our organization. For example, you probably have heard in the United States of a term, affirmative action quota. This term actually meant, when it was first introduced some decades ago, that companies had by law to hire a certain percentage in their workforce from minority groups. So they knew that 10% or 15% or 20 should be coming from Hispanics, from women at some point, because back in those times in the labor force they were considered a minority. Now, what happened later on was that this anti-discriminatory law turned out to go against the local population, because many companies started getting above these limits, and some people, like from the white, from white origin, felt they could not easily find a job, because the HR manager would prefer to get somebody from a minority group in order to abide by the law. And there were cases that were heard in courts. So this is the other extreme. In diversity, however, we're not talking about affirmative action. We're talking about giving opportunities to everybody, regardless of where they come from. And that's what we mean by managing diversity. Why is managing diversity important? First of all, we all live in a global world, and we want to make sure that everybody's creativity and talent are in place in the organization. Suppose you decided to go with some friends from your country to a jungle in the Amazon, and suddenly you realize that you're lost. You have two options. Either get help from some of the people who live in this river, or get one of your people who was with you and has a nice book which is talking about the secrets of this river and how you can survive through the jungle. Who would you rather have to help you? I guess the local, unless you trust your colleague so much. Now, why would you do that? The answer is obvious. Because he knows, and he can save you. Same thing applies in organizations. The fact that we are probably all coming from the same background does not necessarily mean we have the same talents, the same experiences, and we can contribute equally to a certain task. And when we are talking about a globalized economy, we need people who come from different backgrounds because they can understand the local needs of their consumers, for example. Imagine, maybe 20 or 30 years ago, some of these Coca-Cola cans that are being produced during the holidays, Christmas, with Santa Claus. You've seen some ads also. Now imagine this can being sent to an Arab country. How would the Arab people feel about this Coca-Cola can?
Insult?
Well, perhaps not, but they would not feel very happy because they don't actually celebrate Santa Claus, right? Okay? Now, it has happened. At some point, there was a mistake by some of the people in the distribution center who sent a few of these cans to one of the Arab countries. And they didn't do it on purpose. They just didn't realize the need to make sure that what you sent to a country as a product is actually in accordance with what this country preserves, values, and so on and so forth. There's a joke about a shampoo that you can put on your head and hopefully grow hair. I know, Aaron, how you feel. Yeah. I feel worse, don't worry. So I tried it once. And it's this ad where you see yourself before you apply the shampoo, and you see yourself after you apply the shampoo with hopefully more hair. So it goes from this side to this side. Now, if you send the same ad to an Arab country, can you imagine what will happen? Because Arabs actually read from right to left. So they would see a person with long hair, and after applying the shampoo, they will realize that this person does not have the same hair anymore. Okay? And that was, again, an advertisement that 20 or 30 years ago was sent to one of the Arab countries to promote the shampoo, but people were reading it the other way around. And of course, nobody bought it. Why is managing creativity important? It promotes the creativity of people. I mean, managing diversity. It promotes the creativity of people. From different backgrounds, we expect people to be less or more creative. And when you think about creativity and innovation, one of the main things in order to be innovative and creative is to be willing to take risks. There are cultures in the world that are not so risk-taking as opposed to some others. And for an international organization, if they want to combine all these different talents, then it's really important to be able to attract people from these different backgrounds in order to combine the talents and how people relate to risk. Otherwise, if you are in a culture that is, as we say, risk-averse, so they don't take too many risks, you run the risk of not being very innovative and creative. So you need to get people from other countries, or maybe train some of your people to start developing this risk-taking culture that we so need for innovation and creativity. Heterogeneous groups, so people from different backgrounds, religions, race, gender, and so on and so forth, are usually better in solving problems and being excellent at critical analysis. Any ideas why this thing happens? How can we explain this fact, that when you have people who come from different backgrounds, they are more likely to be more creative, to find solutions to problems easier, and also be quite competent in being analytic and critical?
Because they have many points of view to the same problem.
That's definitely one of the reasons. So people look from their own perspective, so they can analyze a problem from all sorts of different backgrounds. Here's a problem for you. You don't do what you do. You're bus drivers, and you do this job for 20 years now. Same route every day. You're starting to get bored. And you like, in order to break monotony, to count how many people get on the bus, how many people leave the bus on every bus stop. Here's the numbers for you. Bus stop number one, 5 people get on the bus. Bus stop number two, 3 people get off the bus, 2 get on the bus. Stop number 3, 7 people get on the bus, 2 people get off the bus. One stop before the left, the last, 4 people get off the bus. Here's the question. What is the color of the eyes of the bus driver? Anybody?
Same as mine.
Sorry?
If I'm a driver, his eyes so is mine.
So, that's the answer actually. But I know that most of us were counting. I really don't know what the result is. You are the drivers. So the color of the eyes of the drivers is your color. Now, why does this thing happen? If we were in a diverse group, there were higher chances of finding the answer, because most of us actually think that the final question would have to do with adding and subtracting. And we leave out something. Is this something I did?
I'm not sure.
No. So they leave out some important information. Diversity achieves exactly the opposite. People can look at things from different perspectives and come up with best solutions to problems. One other extremely important thing in the global economy is that when you have a reputation as a diverse organization, people want to come and work for you. You become the employer of choice. And in our times, attracting and retaining talent at work is one of the pillars to get competitive advantage, regardless of the size of the company. Family, medium-sized, big one, whatever. People know that they will be working in an environment that they are being accepted, treated as equal, and that their strengths and talents can be expressed and applied in full. They would prefer to come and work in such an organization. And we need talents to work and stay with us. A diverse workforce drives economic growth. You have people from different backgrounds who run small businesses. In many countries in the world, small businesses are actually the backbone of the economy. So when you let people exercise their talents, you really help with economic growth of your country. This is coming actually from information in the States. In the last 10 or 15 years, from research they conducted in the States, they found out that the number of women who are now starting their own businesses has increased quite significantly. This has added to the gross domestic product of the country more than 4 to 5%. So the fact that women now have the opportunity to work as entrepreneurs instead of carrying the usual task they used to do 20 or 30 years ago, household duties, they contribute to the development of the economy as well. Diverse workshop workforces capture a greater share of the consumer market. Any ideas what this means?
They can understand more the needs of different cultures and environments.
Okay. This is one thing. You are in a marketing department, you have people from diverse backgrounds, you have products that actually appeal to different prospective clients. So people understand these groups, they understand the needs, and they can appeal to these needs much better than a team of people that is coming from one single background. Would there be anything else in addition to that? Let's put it simply. You have people who work in a company that produces consumer goods and are coming from a minority group. How about, wouldn't the rest of the people from the same group in that country start preferring this product when they know that some of their people are actually working and producing these products? Most likely, yes. So you have the opportunity to appeal to a more diverse clientele. That's what research again has shown. We attract, as we said before, more talented people, a more qualified workforce. And this is one of the greatest advantages in our times, where people can combine their talents. One other important thing, keep turnover costs down. When people know that they work in an all-inclusive organization, they don't really have any reason to leave this organization and go to work somewhere else if they are happy, of course, with the rest of the job they are doing, because they feel they are being treated equally and fairly. The costs to organizations to losing people and hiring new ones are many times quite high, even though now we may think that there are hundreds of CVs waiting in the HR room as candidates to get hired. The pool outside in the labor force may be big, but that does not necessarily mean that all these people are talented and have the right skills for the job we need. How would you feel if you were working in an organization that really caters for your needs, understands your diversity, your differences, accepts that, and makes you feel you're really part of this team? Wouldn't you want to stay in this organization? Yeah, of course, the other things were okay, most likely. In the UK, 10 or 15 years ago, they measured that the cost of replacing an experienced person with approximately 10 years of experience was about £80,000. Now, that's a great sum of money, because what it really means is not only that you find someone else, it also means that you lose the person's intellectual capital and strengths if they leave and go to work for another company. Their own ideas, perhaps, that they take with them, and the money you need in order to train the new person to come. So all this opportunity cost was on average £80,000. Now you can see how important it is to offer a diverse environment where people are willing to stay and reduce your turnover rates. In global organizations, you cannot have a board of directors who are all coming from the same country. If we're talking about an international company, you need people in the board of directors from different backgrounds, from different ethnic groups, in order to understand the company in its global dimensions. Otherwise, you will be limited to how your country understands how business is run. We talked about creativity. We explored why we think a diverse workforce actually helps and forces creativity. We talked about the need to adjust to the changes in our environment and the globalization. And let's look at another perspective now. What it really means to manage diversity in practice. Do we have policies in an organization that provide for understanding, accepting the diversity of people? Is that part of our everyday experience? When we move to a room where people work, do we see there people from different backgrounds who work together and form a team? Ways of thinking in our organizational culture. So can we attract the talents from different groups and have these people apply their talents to create a new product or a new service? Do we need to make changes in the organization so that diversity is really a strategy that leads to the competitive advantages we hope to get? Now, have a look at these two statements. Diversity is not really about treating others as how you want to be treated. It's more treating others as they would like to be treated. Remember the example I gave you before about this immigrant and your motivation scheme. If you apply an ethnocentric strategy when you move to another country, then what you actually think is that your way is the best way and it can be applied all over the world. But when we talk about managing diversity, we are looking at a variety of ways from which we pick the best. So an ethnocentric approach has the high risk of what you think applies in your country, it may not necessarily apply in any other country around the world. And that's really what happened with Walt Disney in Paris when they started their Euro Disney Park. What we see in this park is something that we may see in the other three thematic parks of Euro Disney, of Disney, Florida, California, and Japan. Now, what happened when the HR of Disney were thinking about starting their own park outside Paris? They thought that since California, Florida, and Japan were so successful and they used the same recipe, then they should do the same in France. But originally, that was a great strategic mistake. The Walt Disney organizational culture is very strict. People who work in these parks, even though they put on the Mickey Mouse or Donald Duck mask, work in a very strict environment. No alcohol is allowed during your breaks. You're not allowed to have earrings, or women cannot paint, polish their nails. So it's quite a rigid culture. Now, can you imagine in France a decent French not having a glass of red wine with their meals during their breaks when they work for Disney? French workers are quite casual people. They have long hair. They probably wear an earring. Now, that was not allowed according to what the American culture of Walt Disney wanted to establish in France. And originally, they had great problems because nobody wanted to accept that they had to forget about their own norms and values and habits and just adjust to what a foreign culture was asking them to do. And there was some time that they even went to the labor courts accusing Walt Disney of not following labor rules and habits in France. Finally, Disney had to adjust. This is quite an example of how an ethnocentric approach will fail in some situations. And hopefully, when Disney understood they had to change, they started adjusting to the local needs. What do we really need as managers or leaders in order to lead in a diverse situation? First of all, understanding and accepting diversity. We have to understand that this should be a case in question and a case we are faced with every day. Also, that in every aspect of management, we need to understand that people are not the same. To give you an example, you have a team and you want this team to be creative and come up with new ideas. In addition to thinking about dealing with risk, you need some people who have divergent thinking, some people who have convergent thinking. The difference between the two is that when you think in a diverse way, you may think outside the box. So you can come up with ideas that are outside your comfort zone. But you also need the convergent who is more analytical, can take a problem, break it down, and work with a solution. That's diversity. And the manager should recognize how his or her people think in different ways in order to be able to combine their talents to produce the best possible results. But before you do that, you need to understand your own culture, your own biases, your own prejudices and stereotypes. And of course, fight as a leader to break down barriers from other people who want to think in a stereotypical way against diversity. I would like to go briefly through some of the basic differences among cultures and just give you a flavor of what it means to think in a diverse way. These are some of the key differentials, starting with monochronic and polychronic. I'll just explain these things in a bit. Past and future orientation, private and public space, equality as opposed to hierarchy, individualism as opposed to collectivism, cooperation, competition, low context, high context communication, doing as opposed to being. While we go through these things, please think about your culture. A monochronic culture, or people who come from a monochronic cultural background, like to do one thing at a time and stick to schedules. So you follow a very specific and strict agenda. You don't want to deviate from it. You focus more on the information than on the people. So you're more oriented on getting the job done. As opposed to a polychronic culture, where people focus on several tasks at the same time, they don't depend so much on getting all the details down. Schedules are not very precise, so you could say, well, if we finish this thing yesterday, it's probably a success. That wouldn't be the case with a Swiss, for example. They have to be exact, okay? And there's more emphasis on the people side than on schedules and timetables. So, what would be your idea about your cultures? Should I assume that most people here are from the Czech Republic and, I don't know, Slovak? I know we have one person here from Portugal. Two.
No, I'm Poly. We are Poly.
You're Poly. So, what would be the case with the Czech culture? Would you say you're more monochronic or more polychronic? Any ideas?
I think we are something between.
Okay, in the middle or going towards one or the other side? Which side do you think you are going more?
I really can't say because I think it depends on the person. Depends on the person. But me personally, it's more monochromatic.
Okay. How about the rest of you?
I would say the opposite. I'm Czech as well, and I would say I'm more towards polychrome.
So you can see.
Fine. That's good to know. Well, when the actual research was conducted many, many years ago, the then Czechoslovakia was closer to monochronic. But obviously these things are changing as generations replace older generations. And that's why here two people say exactly the opposite. Okay. Past versus future orientation. A company, a culture that is based more on the past would like to keep the tradition. It's not very open to changing things and forgetting about its tradition. So if we want to make changes, we should be very careful that these changes will not harm our history and put us into a very different direction from now on. We want to get quick results, short-term gains. If you are a future-oriented person or culture or national culture, then you don't care so much about the short-term gains when you know you have to gain more in the future. So the present is not as so important for you as is the future. And you make changes according to what you expect the benefits will be in the future. So where would you put yourselves now in these two extremes? More towards the past or more towards the future?
Czechs are mostly past-oriented. Most of the entrepreneurs and politicians as well, they focus on the short.
Okay, let's not talk about the politicians because in every country they are all the same. There's no cultural difference there. So,
also the companies, I think.
In the companies, you're saying that it's more like a past orientation.
I think they should focus mostly on the short-term gains.
On the short-term gains, yes.
That comparing to some other nations, Czechs are like future oriented. They made a huge progress after the whole Czechoslovakia breakdown compared to the other, let's say, post-Soviet area. Mm-hmm. So it's also the difference of perception of which case and with what are you comparing.
Yes. Well, again, it's in our times, it's really difficult to decide about the whole culture. It may depend also on the organizational culture we work, which is shaping the way we behave. And again, we have to look at how different generations look at things, especially in countries where history suddenly changed the whole situation, and we move from one condition to the other. So until the change is comprehended and we go to the next situation, we are all going to be having this kind of discussion. It depends. You may say some people are future, some people are past. So at this moment, most cultures are in this transition period. We cannot be very exact about whether we are on the one or the other side, at least in Europe, because in some of the other countries outside Europe, things are quite specific. Private versus public. That has to do with our comfort zone. If you are in a culture that places more emphasis on private space, it means you don't want to go outside your comfort zone. Okay? And you keep your personal matters to yourself. You don't discuss your problems, your issues with a neighbor. That's only in the family. As they say, in the States, whatever in Vegas stays in Vegas, doesn't go outside. Okay? As opposed to the public space and culture, where people are very open to talk about personal matters, share them with not only their immediate family, and they talk about family issues, about individual even their failures in the public, and they're quite outside the comfort zone. Now, if you ask me how I feel about people in this country, I can say it is changing from private to a little bit more public. My first experience 10 years ago was that it's more towards the private. I could even feel that on the tram. If you went to sit next to a Czech person, they were not very comfortable. Now it's getting much better and people are more open with the new generations. And that's my feeling. I don't know if you agree with me. But I think that younger people here are beginning to be more public-oriented compared to what was happening with the previous generations. Is that right?
Yeah.
To an extent. Again, it's subjective, but to an extent, I think we're moving, you're moving towards this part. In order to understand the difference between public and private, through proxemics, which means how close people want to be when they interact with each other, we can understand how cultures differ. So, for example, the Arabic countries, Pakistanis and Indians get very close to each other when they talk. So the distance between them could be even less than half a meter. As we move towards the other side, space becomes larger. With Northern Europeans, for instance, the normal distance to talk should be about 2 meters. If you get closer, you have to watch it. You will see the person actually stepping back a little bit because they feel you are getting inside their own comfort zone. So, why is this important to know in managing diversity in an organization? Any ideas? I mean, why do we need to know how different cultures relate to space when they interact with each other?
To not confuse the people, to make them feel comfortable.
Okay. What else can you do when you know this difference?
Space planning. Space planning.
Even space planning. When you have the luxury to adjust your space to the needs of every culture, you are a very happy person. Imagine having people from all these different backgrounds, and you have an office, 10 by 10, and you have to put all these people working in this office, and you have to make sure that Northern Europeans to Arabs keep the right distance. Well, it's not easy. But knowing these things, is there any other situation where it's useful to know these differences in space orientation between people? How about when you negotiate with the other side? Or you talk about a business agreement and you have somebody who's coming from another country. Would that information be important for you?
You can better pick the place where you maybe arrange the meeting.
Pick the place, exactly. Arrange the meeting so that everybody feels comfortable. Know how to keep spaces so that you don't get in the space of the other person because that may make them feel offended. And that increases your chances of reaching, finally, a win-win agreement. So these little details sometimes are the ones that really make a difference in order to be able to work and interact with different people. Equality versus hierarchy. There are cultures that believe that the organization does not really need a structure. Even though there is a structure, people can interact with each other without necessarily using power that they have in the hierarchy. If you are in a hierarchical organization, then you have to follow the pyramid. The boss is there, you are down here, and there's a certain top-down approach that you have to follow. And you accept this norm. When the boss tells you this is what you have to do, you follow it because you know he is the boss. That would be the case in a hierarchical structure. Any ideas about your cultures? Would you say that the present situation here is more hierarchical or more on the equality side? Hard to tell? It's still hierarchical, I think. Not as it was, but it's still, and in many countries, this is still the case. In Greece, it's definitely. Individualism versus collectivism. If you are an individualistic country or person, then you put your own goals first, or your family's goals first. You want to satisfy first what interests you, and then you look at the interests of the group or the organization. As opposed to collectivism, where people put group interests on top, and then their own individual interests. A good example for this is if you ask somebody from the Western type economy, what do you do for a living? And you ask the same question a Japanese, you will get two different answers. So the person from the Western type economy, they will say probably, well, I am an engineer and I work for Microsoft. The person from Japan would say, I work for Matsushita Electrical Company and I am an engineer. And this is clearly a difference of how they see the two cultures, their role in an organization. Western type economies are more individualistic. The Asian cultures and some of the Mediterranean cultures as well tend to be a little bit more collectivist. The difference between individualism and collectivism also relates to how we deal with conflict. Now, this is a chart that shows different styles of dealing with conflict. When we deal with conflict, we either want to protect our own interests, so save our face, or work towards saving the face of the other person. And that also happens when we express our emotions. Now, from culture to culture, if you are in an individualistic culture, you would go straight to the other person and tell them what you think about them. And you don't perhaps care so much whether this person loses face if you do it in public. If you come from a more collectivist culture, then the opposite may happen. And you have a problem with somebody, you're not going to tell them straight to the face, and you would never do that in public. These are the two extremes. There have been cases in many countries where people from Western type economies moved to some of the Asian countries to work on projects, and they were using their own style of directing or talking to fellow workers from China or from Japan or from the rest of the Asian countries. They did that in the way they would do it in their own country. And the person from China lost face. They did not feel very nice about it, even though they knew the boss was right. So even how you deal with these communication issues, especially when emotions come into place, is something we need to consider when we deal with people from a diverse group. We're very close. I have another 250 slides and I'm done. Okay. Cooperation as opposed to competition. I guess these two words speak for themselves. We either work together in teams, we also emphasize quality of life, work-life balance, or we're more competitive, we want to achieve, we want to be recognized for the wealth we have generated as a result of our work. So here again we may distinguish cultures that are more cooperative compared to cultures that are more competitive. And I will give you some examples in a bit. Here is an interesting dimension. the difference between a low context culture and a high context culture. This is what differentiates cultures in terms of the way they communicate. And I have an example for you, and you tell me what kind of culture you think this is, low context or high context. So two monks are walking in the gardens of the monastery, and they walk and pray as they do all day. At one moment, the younger monk turns to the senior monk and says, "Brother, may I ask you a question?" The senior monk says, "Of course." And the younger one says, I wonder how can you smoke while you pray?" And the senior monk says, why do you ask this question?" The junior says, "Well, because when I came to the monastery and went to our father to ask for permission, he categorically said no." So the senior monk says, "Then I gather, my brother, that you asked for permission to smoke during pray time." The monk says, "Yes." And the father even said, "I wonder, how dare you ask this question?" And the senior monk said, "Then, my brother, you asked the wrong question. Because when I came to the monastery and went to our father, I said, 'Father, may I pray when I smoke?' And the father said, 'Of course, my son, you can pray all day.'" Now, where was the low context? Where was the high context? Who was low context? Who was high context among these two monks? Any ideas?
Smoking monk was the high context.
Sorry?
The smoking monk.
The smoking monk.
Yeah.
So you mean the senior?
The senior.
Yes. The other one went straight. Low concept, "May I smoke?" And the father said no. The other one said, "May I pray when I smoke?" And he said, "Yes, you may pray." He forgot about smoking. That's low context. That's high context. Messages are implicit. They are hidden behind the words. In a low context culture, things are very specific. Even when you sign a contract and you read the contract, everything is there, clear and specific. You don't miss a line. If you read a contract in my country, you won't have a clue what this contract is talking about. You can come 2 days later and look at it and say, "Well, was that the contract I was reading 2 days ago? Or was I dreaming?" And there are many cultures that have this idea of being very high in context, which means that all the messages, you need to look at them a second time in order to understand what is hidden behind. This does not mean that one communication is better than the other. It's just how people interact. And here is the chart where different cultures are put on this continuum. As you can see, the Swiss at the bottom, very low context. Things are precise and exact in this country by the mini second. If you now move to the other side with Japanese and Arabs on the other hand, they are very, very high context. Now imagine the challenge between a Swiss and an Arab trying to get into some kind of negotiations. And each one of them applies their own style of communication. It has happened. Some of the first companies from the States that went to China, when China opened its borders to the rest of the world, they failed in their negotiations because they would not understand this great difference between low context and high context. The American side want to go straight to the point, talk about business. And they had all the facts in place, and they want to talk about the reason they were there. The Chinese, on the other hand, being high context, wanted first to establish a relationship. So they want to talk about general things, social things, even hobbies and interests, even family interests, until they end up with talking about business. And many times, especially in Japan, the Japanese team would actually leave the room where the negotiations were taking place without giving any kind of answer, just bowing gently. And then it took like 2 or 3 months for them to come back to give the response. Because they want to think about it, they want everybody to participate in the decision making, they want to make sure, first of all, that a relationship of trust has been established before they move to talk about business. But the Anglo-Saxon style is more direct. Let's talk about business now, and let's have all the facts on the table. The Japanese would not go with all the information, not because they want to hide something, but because they thought that was not the time to have all the information, since we haven't built trust first. And there were many situations that negotiations failed for these reasons, not because there was a real disagreement between the two cultures. There's also the difference between being and doing. In which culture have you heard the term, I live to work? In which culture have you heard the term, I work to live? What would be the first one? I live to work.
Japanese.
It's more like the Anglo-Saxon. It's this guy here.
American.
Yeah. There you see? I live to work. He's proud about that.
Sorry, I was doing a few other things here.
In Scandinavian countries, you would hear the opposite. I work to live. I'm more concerned about work-life balance, relationships, feeling happy with what I'm doing, and then I look at using my life just because I need to work. Where are you? What do you think you are? On the living to work or working to live side? Well, again, that's probably something personal.
Work to live?
Yes. I think so. I think in many European countries, even though people now work really hard because of the situation, there is still this idea of looking for the best possible balance between work and life. So in some of our countries, not so much in the neighboring countries, this idea about working to live, so having fun at the same time, if you like, is part and parcel of how we see our lives. And that's my personal opinion. I hope it stays like that. That's the difference, in short, between being and doing. Let's see how we can put these things together. You have a diverse IT after sales workforce. So a company that is based in 15 different countries in Europe, and they have IT people who work in the after sales service of this company. What would be some of the issues you would consider in order to motivate your workforce? Would you use the same motivation schemes that apply in Czech Republic and Slovakia compared to Bulgaria, Serbia, Greece, or some of the other countries? Or would you try to consider how people are motivated according to their own cultural background?
You need to consider their own cultural background.
You have to consider their own cultural background. Now, here is, I don't want you to read this thing, you don't have to memorize all these numbers. Here is from some research conducted by Mercer. It's an international consulting firm. How different countries in the world relate to factors that influence motivation and engagement at work. I'll just go through this slide quickly just to give you some examples. Globally, one of the most important things is to be treated with respect. So people want in the world to know that they are being treated with respect. But as you can see, between France, Germany, UK, China, Hong Kong, Singapore, and the US, this is not always on the same line. So for the French, the Brits, and US, that's really a top priority, and it goes on top. Same thing with Germany, but it's a little bit close to the global average. In China, Hong Kong, and Singapore, who are similar cultures, this is important, but not as important as in other countries. So if you were having a diverse IT after sales group with people coming from these different nationalities, how would this factor affect you in the way you would motivate these people? What would you do? You are the manager running this diverse workforce. Any ideas?
For example, you can see that people in Hong Kong care a lot about money, much more than mm-hmm. people in France, for example, a bit more.
So it would take, you picked Singapore, you said?
Singapore.
Yeah.
Hong Kong.
Hong Kong.
Base pay.
Well, it's the same. Yeah. Okay. So base pay for Hong Kong is at the top. They care more about getting money. For them, respect is important, but not as important as for another culture. So obviously, when you have a team in Hong Kong, you have to take this into consideration. Because if you say, I'm going to apply global standards to motivate this force, you have a high risk of actually not engaging everybody to the same level. And this is what this slide is talking about. I don't want to bore you with figures because that's helpful, but you need time to look at it. However, this is available research that exists around the world, and HR companies of global firms use it in order to think about, yes?
Could you say, for example, it could also have to do with the development of a country's economy. For example, in China, people seem to have lower expectations in general. For example, about the people they work with, about the work-life balance, about having flexible...
So you're saying that this has to do with the state of the economy?
The development of the economy, so in more... I wouldn't say economy, they have a strong economy, but I mean, in Europe, people are more used to having nicer things, I would say, to getting all the benefits and perks, and more flexibility, etc., while in China, because of it's still... dictatorship, communist country, people don't put so much emphasis on that.
This is a likelihood. It could be one of the explanations, which means that if we met again 30 years later to talk about the same topic, would they expect the Chinese to be different compared to how they are today? Maybe. But for cultural values in order to change so abruptly, we need to be thinking about two or three generations later. If you take situations, economies like the Greek economy or some of the other economies that suffer from the crisis, and you went through this model again, I'm sure that the majority of people who don't feel very safe about keeping their jobs would be interested at this moment in base pay because they need the money to feed their families. So respect would be important, but maybe not at the moment top priority. If 20 years later the situation hopefully changes and the economy is better off and we do this research again, it could be that in those times people again move to higher level needs than just how much money they're making. So again, it depends. It depends on the situation. I would say to your question, this is most likely one of the explanations. Absolutely.
How was the research done? Because it also may be differences in the answering from different cultures. For example, the high context culture may respond another way than another cultures.
You mean to the same questions here?
Well,
the statistical error, or the margin of error, if you like, in this. Okay. So the margin of error in this white research is very small, because they take into consideration these differences. So when they formulate their questionnaires to each language, they try to adjust to how each culture would understand the question, so they don't answer it in a biased way.
And where can I find them?
You mean where you can find, this is Mercer, M-E-R-C-E-R. It's the Mercer report on motivation.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Now, ladies and gentlemen, as they say in courts, I rest my case. How much more time do we have?
Still got about 15 minutes.
15 minutes.
10 minutes.
10 minutes. Okay. So as they say when somebody finishes a lecture, who has the first question? Though you have already asked. So, yes?
One question. It was about private and public, how people feel they exchange information. Isn't it looks like that it depends on their way of living in the country? Because if people have a comfort zone, maybe inside this house, so they can reduce these feelings outside. And if life is not so good, they hide inside.
Absolutely. This is also one reason how people understand space, of course. When you are in a country where people have their home and then around it they have a huge, you know, garden, so they don't really feel they are very close to each other, they understand space in a very different way. But if you are in a country of 100 or 200 million people, where people live literally one right next to the other and one is stuck to the other, because that's the situation, they understand space also in a different way. But doesn't that affect also how they interact? So again, in the business context, going back to what I said about negotiations, for instance, how you relate with the space of the other person is extremely important in ensuring that you end up with a win-win result at the end.
But I think Asian and Arabic countries live more like houses and have more space.
That's not how they started, how their civilization started. Don't forget that Arabic, most of the people when they were living in the desert, they were very close communities. So this thing is still with their DNA. No matter if the economy is different and now they have, you know, huge places where they live. But the original idea about how close we can get is also affected by the history of a culture. Next question. Yes, sir.
Just one remark. You have been talking about benefits mostly.
Of diversity.
Diversity.
Yes.
But there is another side of the coin.
Okay.
That's the costs. Because the higher diversity brings higher costs in managing the diversity. For example, you need HR to be more thrifty. Or maybe you need two HR persons. You need, for example, when you have got a purely male group and just one female, you have to build different restrooms, for example, and so on and so on. So this is the additional cost, and the managers have to take them into consideration as well.
Obviously, how much you invest in diversity should be one of your concerns, if you like. I tend to think, looking at the results of many companies that have invested in diversity, that their return on investment is always positive. So yes, there is a cost, obviously. You have to look at it compared to what you gain. And the story has shown that if diversity is managed in the right way, then what, how much it costs you is less than the benefits you enjoy at the end. At least that's the experience from companies that are now, you know, have this diversity practice in their backbone. Next question.
Do you think that it is beneficial for a company, say in Czech Republic, medium-sized company, to kind of get into diversity to attract people from different countries? I'm talking about a company that's mostly focused on domestic market and maybe to neighboring countries, not really a big company, mm-hmm. not a global company at all.
I understand the question. In a case of any company, not only in the Czech Republic, but any company that is looking to satisfy the domestic needs, maybe getting people from another culture is not the solution to managing diversity. But as we said before, diversity is not only about attracting people from another culture. It's also about helping your people to think in diverse ways. Somebody doesn't like me hearing this.
I think it might be your phone, but I'm not sure.
No, it's not working.
Ah,
okay. So, if I were running a business like this, here or in my country or in any other place, and I know I'm only looking at the local, the domestic market, then definitely bringing someone from another country would be a risk if they don't know anything about the local culture and the local needs. I would invest more time and effort to help my people, who are locals as well, to think in more diverse terms. So try to look for opportunities to expand in the local market, maybe in new client groups. Try to think in more divergent ways. Try to think out of the box, or maybe understand business outside these barriers of resisting to change. So be more open to change. So it would probably work with creating diversity among the people I have in my team who are coming from the same background. Unless I can find somebody from another country who has such an international experience, he's so good, that can adjust to every company in every part of the world, you know, on just 1 or 2 days. But that is highly, needs a lot of money to spend, and that's the risk. So I would spend more time with my people and help them understand what diversity really means. We have time for one more question, maybe two. Then I will ask you a question. Leaving this room today, what would be one thing you would take with you and perhaps start considering from the topic we discussed?
That our perspective might not always be the best one, and that we have to look at each thing from different angles to find the best solution.
That's right. Don't think that your solution is a recipe for everything. In some cases, you need to get another side of the coin. It may be better as a solution to a problem. So don't always look at things as you understand them or as we understand them from our own cultural viewpoint. Something else? And don't think of diversity only, as we said before, that is race, gender, or religion. It's much more than that. Combining different talents in a globalized world where everybody's strengths must be a good match with the strengths of the other people. Thank you very much.
Thank you.